This is the planet we still know so little of. We call it Earth, but less than one-third is land. Over two-thirds is water. We use that water as a dumping site for our waste, and as if it is an inexhaustible horn of plenty for humans. Our most important ecosystem is on the verge of collapse unless we act now.
This picture took me about two dives, a little more than two dives, and it was in the third dive that immediately the fish recognized me and thought, oh yeah, that's not a predator. And he allowed me to come very close, and within minutes I had this picture. If you get a chance and picture the eye of a fish, yeah, that's fantastic. And this is funny because this is the anus of a starfish. At this very moment, the main problem with the oceans is that they're getting emptier and emptier. If we don't do anything, then we face one of the biggest disasters in history of mankind.
Dos Winkel, diver, photographer, and conservationist. Revered for his close-ups of fish eyes, fins, or skin, no larger than a few millimeters, enlarged to a degree that they become abstract works of art. His maiden dive was in 1985 and heralded his addiction to the underwater world. Thousands of photographs and 25 years on, he is a passionate advocate for the preservation of healthy oceans. He travels the globe with his exhibitions, using his photos as weapons in the fight against the destruction of marine life.
If you look at the predators only, about 90% of all predatory fish is gone. Then from all the other commercial fish species, almost 80% is gone. The best thing to do to solve the problem is to quit eating fish. People who don't dive have no idea how beautiful the underwater world is. The biodiversity is so immense, and you see the most amazing creatures. What you can see underwater is art, top art.
Everywhere Dos dives, he is faced with devastation. Taking a passive stance was not an option. He seizes every opportunity to use his photographs and tell the story of a world that is on the verge of vanishing.
We're destroying the underwater ecosystems in a speed which is almost unthinkable. Scientists found out that if we continue fishing the way we are doing now, in 30 years from now, the oceans will be empty. There will be no more edible fish left.
Is it conceivable that the oceans will be empty in 30 years? If so, we humans are responsible. Two young marine biologists set out to do research for us, Marianne van Mierlo and Barbara van Genne.
Well, I studied for 5 years and now I can call myself a Master of Science in Marine Biology. But I never knew that the problems in the oceans were this serious. If this is all true, it's really, really shocking, and I'm really eager to find out more about this.
In this film, we sum up the facts. Why our seas and oceans are in great danger. We find this survey by the University of British Columbia. Fish stocks in the North Atlantic Ocean in 1900. Megatons of fish in the sea. The next image is 100 years later. Nearly everything is gone.
Maar ik vind het ook schokkend dat hier gewoon echt bijna niks meer is. Terwijl hier heel veel.
This shows the fish in the North Atlantic in 1900, where there was about 10 tons per square kilometer on the shelves. And next, the same in 2000, when we had essentially reduced all the fish to 1/10 or less of the biomass. So we went from this to that in 100 years.
Professor Daniel Pawley has been publishing about the effects of global overfishing for years.
We have a situation where we are already starting many decades losing. We're losing fish population at an increasing rate.
Pawley is one of the most renowned researchers concerning the state of the oceans. For his work, he has received honorary doctorates from universities in Greece, Belgium, Canada, Portugal, and the Netherlands.
The process of destruction of the ocean has long begun.
Where and when did things go wrong? People have been fishing for centuries. The Netherlands, for example, made a bundle in the 16th and 17th centuries with herring fishing, and the Dutch played a major role in the whaling industry also. Only when a whaling quota was set in 1946 did this form of hunting end for the Netherlands. It marked the first international commitment restricting the catch of a sea animal. From the 1970s, a limit was imposed on fish catches for member states of the EU. It became apparent that the sea was not an inexhaustible source of bounty. But despite the quota, there was an upsizing of ships, the fishing areas expanded, and technological instruments such as sonar meant that fish had no place to hide. Since catch quota were introduced, the annual fish catch consistently exceeds what scientists deem wise. On average, the European Union sets a quota that is no less than 48% higher than scientists recommend.
The Ministry of Fisheries in most countries is acting on behalf of fleet owners of the fishery. They're acting on the perceived benefit of the fisheries, of the fishers, which are always short term.
Since the 1950s, global fish catches have quadrupled. We take almost 100 million tons of fish from the sea every year.
Most fisheries in the world continue only because we subsidize them. In other words, we give them money to go catch fish. Subsidizing a fishery means to encourage the fishers to go after fish that are so rare that it's not worth fishing them economically. The moment we decide to subsidize fisheries, we encourage destruction.
St. John's, capital of Newfoundland on the east coast of Canada, famous for its rich fishing grounds. For centuries, this was the epicenter of the cod fishing industry.
When he thinks about tomorrow, he fears for his son. Oh, where are the codfish? Oh, what has gone wrong?
Hi.
Hi, Barbara.
Yes.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Welcome, come in, come
Thank
in.
You.
Pius Coombs himself was a cod fisherman.
Oh, look at this.
And this is all codfish here, and those were huge codfish.
They are.
And those ones, you can see, that's me actually holding them.
So he's half your size.
It's half the size of me.
Wow. This is also cod?
This is also codfish, yeah. And I'm probably looking at 20,000 pound or 10,000 kilogram in this one.
Yeah. It's huge.
Oh, where are the codfish? Oh, what has gone wrong?
Pius grew up in the small village of Portugal Cove, one of hundreds of similar villages along the Newfoundland coast.
There was big families here.
Yeah.
Even this house here, is my uncle. They had 16 children. So there was quite a few children growing up at that same time. And in the summertime, you spend your time on the wharf, very curious, watching the fishermen come in and landing their catches. So
you grew up
looking at the water, watching the fishermen come in and waiting for the day you'd be old enough to go out and fish with them.
Fish yourself.
Yeah.
And how old were you when you went fishing for the first time?
13-year-old when I first started going out in the boat with father and hauling the cod traps.
This is Barbara.
Hello.
Glad to meet you, Barbara.
Nice to meet you.
3 months the fishing season used to last for Pius and his father. Only during the summer months, when the cod came too close to shore, would they set cod traps, as they had done for generations.
You come in here anymore with your boat, the shover under this. Then there's ropes here to haul up the foot.
To haul up the bottom.
Lift it up.
With the trap skiff, the traditional Newfoundland fishing boat, the cod traps would be emptied in the morning. A small-scale fishing method that provided a fine source of income for thousands of people.
It was really a good living years ago, fishing. Well, there's nothing else, sure, and running. Only fishing.
40, 50 years ago.
Yo.
If you said there was never going to be any more codfish here, people would laugh. Say, no way, it's impossible.
For centuries, cod fishing took place in Newfoundland. It seemed to be limitless. But in the late 60s, the big boys from Europe arrived. They used heavy equipment to hunt down cod. 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. And the Canadians themselves also built a trawler fleet.
In 10 days on a trawler, we could catch more than we did all year from a trap fish. And I mean, we were one trawler. There was hundreds of trawlers out there doing the same thing and continuously for 12 months of the year. It was massive, the amount of fish that was coming out of the water.
Did it seem like a good thing to you back then?
At first I thought, wow, this is really great, this is good money. And but as the years went on, I could see this, you know, there's so many boats there and there's hundreds of boats out there doing the same thing. And then I started thinking, you know, how can the fish sustain?
Yeah.
I mean, it's only obvious if you're taking so much out and if it can't replenish at the same rate, eventually you're going to keep taking out so much until there's nothing left.
An unbelievable amount of fish was reeled in from the seas in no time at all, resulting in the collapse of fish stocks. Biologists issued warnings, but the government did nothing.
None of them had the guts to make that decision to say, let's cut half those plants away, let's take half the fishermen out of it. They said that would be the end of the communities, the rural communities that fully depended on the fishery. But Okay. Failing to do that, yeah. They waited until everything was gone.
Yeah.
In 1992, here in Newfoundland, the cod stocks had been depleted to such a point that they announced a moratorium, which completely closed the cod fishery here in the island. Put close to 40,000 people out of work. It was probably the biggest mass layoff in Canadian history. First announced, they said they'd close the fishery for 2 years and evaluate again, and hopefully the stocks would rebuild enough to sustain a small fishery. But 2 years after, it was even less, I think, in the fishery. And here we are now, 18 years later, and it's still no concrete proof of any substantial growth in the stock at all. When he thinks about tomorrow, he fears for his son. Oh, where are the codfish? Oh, what has gone wrong?
Something that most people don't know is that cods are still being killed by fishing gear. There is a shrimp fishery now in Newfoundland, and the shrimp co-occur in the same place with a small cod, and the small cod are caught as bycatch. So people sometimes wonder why the cod don't reestablish themselves, and they blame the seals for this. They say all the seals. But the fishery, in a sense, it continues, except that it is on small cod, which are discarded. What is needed is zero catch, a long time, so that it builds up. And when it has built up, then you can get again big catches. But it will not build up again if you continue to catch it.
Can you empty a sea? Well, yes, you can. It's the stone-cold reality in Newfoundland. It is no different elsewhere. From the 50s and 60s, fishing began to take place on a huge scale. Bottom trawlers with enormous nets besiege the oceans. Nets with steel chains scrape the ocean beds. An efficient way to catch vast amounts in a short period of time. The fact that this was destroying a valuable ecosystem escaped everyone's attention.
I was taught when I was in the university that this doesn't matter because the fish don't need the bottom. But actually, it's not true. The young fish need to be in habitat that's structured like reefs because they minimize the energy expenditures if they can hide where the current is not strong. When trawling happens, it essentially laminates, it flattens up everything. It destroys the structures that the animals have built. And so the recruitment goes down, the production of young fish goes down. And so the stock goes down and cannot be reestablished because to build this structure, it's like a forest underwater. It takes hundreds of years. And a trawl will eliminate this by one passage. Trawling is as if you were fishing with you were catching rabbits with a bulldozer in a garden. You know, there is a garden, and you have to catch some animals or some plants, and you bulldoze everything. What do you expect?
Think of it like this: if you were to drag a net over the savannas in the hunt for buffalo, the bycatch would be equally immense. Even sustainable fishing does not always prove to be a good alternative. Fisheries with a sustainable label take the spawning seasons of fish into consideration, so they do not hunt fish all year round. But even trawler fisheries can obtain sustainability certificates these days.
If you certify a trawl fishery, which is, it's almost a contradiction in term. A trawl fishery modifies the habitat it is in. It cannot be sustainable.
Professor Pawley was enthusiastic about the MSC label initiative when it was first founded, but has lost confidence in sustainable fishing since then.
I believe now that the MSC is a certification for good practices, not relatively good practices, not sustainability.
Bonaire is the warmest place belonging to the Netherlands, a holiday paradise for water sports enthusiasts. Commercial fishing is prohibited, and there is a mandatory charge for every diver who enters its waters, $25 that goes towards the protection of the sea. Fish are to be looked at only, and there are several ways to do so.
They use worldwide the Bonaire model, how to establish a marine park. It's the best protected area in the world.
On land, about 10 to 15% of the land is forested or protected in parks. In the water, is less than 1%.
Doss and his family lived on this island for 10 years, and it is still his favorite diving location. He has seen and photographed every underwater site hundreds of times.
Here, you see the big stuff. You see sharks sometimes. Almost every dive, you see these wonderful eagle rays. You see big stingrays, you see turtles, every dive's almost guaranteed, and big schools of fish. Fantastic. It is an almost perfect coral reef. If you're underwater and you're diving a coral reef, oh wow, you see thousands, no, millions of animals, because even the coral polyps are animals. So you see animals everywhere. And to be weightless and in between all these fantastically colored and moving animals is a delight.
So the waters around Bonaire are a protected marine park, one of the few in the world. And despite clear international agreements to shield off many more sea areas from commercial fishing, it is yet to happen.
The ministers of the environment of basically all countries in the world have agreed on 20% by 2020. Now, the target of having 10% by 2010, that was also by the ministers and stuff, is missed by a factor of 10. We don't have even 10% of what we said we should have in 2010. So we will miss also the 2020 target by an immense amount. There is a huge disconnect between what we said we need and we will do by the government and what we actually do.
We have 7 species of sea turtles in the oceans, beautiful marine reptiles. 6 species are almost extinct because of fisheries, destructive types of fisheries, like longline fishing. We have 22 million kilometers of long lines in the oceans.
And the line can be hundreds of kilometers, and the hooks will be thousands and thousands and thousands of hooks. And these hooks are baited, so they attract all kinds of animals, tuna, sharks, turtles, dolphins.
And every hook gets a victim. A sea turtle, a shark, a tuna, a dolphin, and they die a terrible death. It takes them 12 to 24 hours of fighting before they die.
And everything is thrown overboard that is not tuna. And that's one reason why the turtles, the back turtle, for example, are going down everywhere.
Bycatch in the fishing industry is a daily phenomenon. Most of all fish caught globally is caught using large, indiscriminate nets. And they drag up everything they come across.
The common fishery policy, for example, forbids you to land fish for which you don't have a license. So you have a license to fish cod, you cannot land a hake or something. And that's one reason. Another reason, because they are interested only in the best part of the catch. So they are not interested in freezing and processing fish that for which they get a low price. So they discard it. If you have one portion of fish, another fish of the same quantity of fish was discarded. And if you are interested in shrimp, that is 10 times.
According to a recent scientific study in marine policy, 40% of the fish that is caught is thrown overboard or discarded later, dead.
This is a very important mangrove area here in Bonaire. Mangroves are plants, and the roots continue underwater and are heavily overgrown with algae and weeds and oysters and sponges. And they're the perfect place for small fish to grow up. These are very, very important nurseries. Bonaire is very well protected, but worldwide we have a big, big problem, because most of the mangrove areas are completely gone in the meantime. They've been harvested and have been turned into shrimp factories. We take this channel here.
Yeah, we go right in there.
And then to our famous...
Looks like the tide is really flat.
It's so calm, huh?
Really calm.
So this is the perfect moment, because when you're in between the tides, then there is no current, and then you have the best visibility. So for our photography and filming, this is absolutely perfect. For me, it's a fairy tale forest. It's so beautiful, and especially because of the fact that you have all these light effects coming through the water, and you see the sun rays dancing on the fish. It's fantastic. This is the upside-down jellyfish, Cassiopeia. It's a typical mangrove animal. The flat side is down, and the tentacles are up. And they're very important filterers for the mangrove system.
So they're endemic actually to mangrove areas and estuaries. So now he's gonna swim. Come on, boy. So now he's gonna swim back to the bottom. See the tentacles going up? And next to me there is a big one here. There is a deeper part here in the mangroves, and you see thousands of them. There's a juvenile barracuda here. It's only this big. One of the problems, even here on Bonaire, although it's extremely well protected, is the fact that we see less and less fish. And that's because of the fact that not far from here, the northern part of South America, that's where they ruin all the beautiful mangrove forests now. Worldwide, about 80 to 90% of all the mangrove forests worldwide are gone. Well, we have the overfishing already. We have all the bycatch. So many animals die because of fishery industries. And then also taking away the nurseries is really a big shame.
The oceans are becoming emptier by the day. But at the same time, as consumers, we are told, eat more fish because it's good for you. Is fish really all that healthy? We go to the market in Amsterdam. You can buy fish here from all corners of the world.
Hoe zwaar mogen ze ongeveer zijn?
Half pond ongeveer.
Oké, sta ik even.
Dankjewel.
At a fishmonger's with an excellent reputation, we buy tuna and swordfish, both from the Indian Ocean. Two fillets of fish we will test for toxins. The fishmonger is confident.
Ja, zeker vind ik dat vis gezond is, uiteraard. Er wordt niks toegevoegd of ingespoten. Mm-hmm. Dus het is puur natuur. Dus okay. Het moet goed wezen.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
I bought the fish.
Very good. Let's go.
Okay.
Dr. Stefan van Leeuwen obtained his PhD with research into toxic compounds in fish.
This is where the extraction occurs. Hi Martin, here I have the two samples that we're going to analyze. This one is the swordfish and this one is the tuna.
In the world of toxicology, there are a few basic rules. In general, large fish contain more toxins than small fish. Fish caught near the coast is usually more contaminated than fish caught out in the open sea. Our newly purchased fish was caught in the relatively clean Indian Ocean. We have it analyzed for mercury.
At a very high exposure, it can be really lethal. People can die of that. But already at lower levels, you'll find subtle effects. For instance, the negative effects on the brain development of little children.
In a few weeks, we will receive the analysis results. Bonaire is an island with an underwater national park, but that cannot prevent pollution from the seas from washing up on its shores. Every day, the waves carry in vast amounts of waste, dumped somewhere in the sea. And what ends up in the sea often ends up in fish.
There is so much poison in the fish. Dioxins, PCBs, flame retardants. We don't even know what the consequences are. See, it looked like stones, but in fact, it isn't. It's very soft. It is just parts of mattresses, and the beach here is full of this. And fish eat it, because what happens in the ocean is you rub it, and all these parts are eaten by fish. They think it's plankton. And the fish is eaten by people. And it's highly toxic. Scientists found
thousands of chemical substances in the oceans, contaminants. And it's not only the PCBs and the dioxins. Of course, that's a big, big problem. And the mercury, but it's also all these parts of plastic and other materials. You can clean the beach, and within a few months' time, you have the same amount like thousands and thousands of plastic bottles. Makes me very angry. It makes me very angry. Very, very angry. Everybody has heard in the meantime about this huge plastic soup. It's like a plastic island in the middle of the ocean. It's about as big as half the size of Europe.
It's so easy. You dump your waste overboard, and a moment later, it's gone. Good riddance to bad rubbish. But underwater, it becomes a mess. Fish mistake waste for food. Especially the plastic particles are harmful. Toxins attach themselves to these particles, and so the waste we dump ends up in our own stomachs.
I don't eat eel and not mussel and not tuna fish.
Why not?
Because of the toxic compounds.
Our consumptive society is taking its toll. Everything we use, we also throw away. Plastic, the miracle material that brought us such affluence, is a great source of distress for the oceans.
The fish that are most contaminated are the fish that are top predators, and especially if they feed on fish that come from polluted areas.
The 1970s and 80s marked the highest levels of pollution known in the West. Waste was dumped on a massive scale, with enormous consequences. Rivers and seas were brimming with toxins such as dioxins and PCBs. There were frequent reports of eels with cancerous tumors. These years saw the rise of the environmental movement. Greenpeace, for example, took action against the dumping of waste in the seas. The realization that we can't simply throw our litter overboard has gained ground, and the emission of dioxins has decreased sharply.
Dioxins and PCBs are still found in fish, and although we've seen a decrease over the last decades, it's still there. It's still in the environment, still there.
The tuna fish can be very big, old, and they eat a lot of other fish, and they are the most contaminated fish. They contain a lot of methyl mercury, also shark and swordfish, for instance.
And whether or not if it is a problem, that depends very much on the amount that is found in the fish samples.
If you eat a lot of the wrong type of fish, then especially unborn children could be affected.
We are back at the Free University in Amsterdam. The results of the mercury level analysis of our tuna and swordfish fillets are in.
It's good to know that the European Union has set a maximum level of what is maximum allowed in fish for mercury. So if we look at the tuna, you see that it's well below this safe limit of 1 milligram per kilogram. But if you look at the swordfish, then we see that swordfish is above this maximum level.
On average, the Dutch eat fish once every 15 days. In our own survey, we assumed an intake of 600 grams of fish per week, as this is considered a safe amount by the Dutch Nutritional Centre.
And the WHO has set a maximum limit to what is allowed to ingest in a week time, and that is set at 0.2 milligram. So if you look at the tuna, and if you consume 600 grams of tuna, we still stay below this safe limit. But if we look at the swordfish, it is approximately 4 to 5 times above this safe limit.
Okay, so should pregnant women eat those fishes?
Pregnant women should be very cautious with consuming, for instance, this swordfish sample. Certainly not every week 600 grams.
Okay.
So eating fish is like Russian roulette. That 100% natural is 100% healthy doesn't hold true by far for every fish. Fish are cold-blooded and oblivious to pain. That's what people used to believe. These are images from The End of the Line, a film with Charles Clover, a British journalist who, like Doss, warns us of the consequences of global overfishing.
Can you imagine that a fish could do without consciousness? What if you do not know what's going on around you? Impossible.
Professor Geert Flick is head of the Department of Animal Physiology at the University of Nijmegen and researches stress and pain in fish.
So how long have you been doing research about fish?
Yeah, believe it or not, for more than 30 years now.
30 years?
I started before you were born, so it is because of my fascination for fish. I really enjoy working with these animals, yes. And they're beautiful. I really like
and
them.
And you still enjoy it?
Oh yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Flick has found that not only do fish experience pain and stress, they are also capable of retaining long-term memories.
Some people want us to believe that the memory of a fish is a matter of seconds. That's not true. If you condition a cod or a salmon or a halibut with light stimuli and then give it a reward, say nice food, the fish learn that very quickly. Say in a few trials they know already that the light is linked to a nice reward after a while, but they also remember that for at least 3 months. If you don't know what it is to meet a predator, you're dead.
Yeah.
So you better know what's going on. And yes, the neuronal systems are there in fish, similar to what we have to perceive pain. If you see fish, say, on deck, move and try to escape and things like that. If you know what it means, if you see what the fish is trying to do, you should make up your mind. Large-scale fishing, which is the most criticized form of fishing, where huge volumes of fish are taken into a big net and then taken out of the water, air exposed. We know that the netting and the air exposure is a severe stress for fish. That's one thing, but then being pushed together, I mean crushed together in a big net and then thrown on deck of a ship, that must be a very fearful and painful event for the fish. If you consider the fish a sentient being, you cannot do that. I mean, you wouldn't do that with 100 cats or 100 dogs or 100 pigs or 100 chickens. You simply should not do that. I think from an ethical point of view, the large-scale big nets fishing where the fish are pushed together and die under the pressure of other fish in large volumes, I think that is not acceptable. We should not do that and try to avoid it as soon as possible.
Some people consider the thought of not eating fish painful, but the pain it prevents fish from experiencing is so much greater. Globally, we catch 100 million tons of fish, the greater part of which is for human consumption. But one third of the catch is ground into fish meal.
About a third of the fish caught in the world, about 30 million tons per year, are caught and turned into fish meal.
This means that over 30 million tons of wild fish is caught in part to feed farmed fish.
You need about 3 kilos of anchovies to produce 1 kilo of salmon.
But ground fish is also on the menu for other animals.
Pigs and Dutch pigs and chicken and so on. And this is a tremendous waste of good food, obviously.
So fish are ground into meal, which is used in the rearing of livestock. Despite the fact that since 2000, feeding pulverized animals to other animals has been banned in the EU, this isn't so for fish. And so they end up on the plates of farmed fish, the pigs, and the chickens. Fish are also used to make pills. Pharmacies, drug and health stores sell them in large amounts.
Fish oil is a subject that really makes me angry.
So the oil that we get from fish, we put in pills. The oil consists of omega-3 fatty acids, and that's what we're after. But fish are made up of only 3 to 5% oil. So you need a lot of fish for just 1 liter.
You need many, many kilos of fish. In the best case, it's maybe 20 kilos of fish in order to get 1 liter of fish oil.
If you believe the labels, it's good for nearly everything. It improves learning in children. It's good for your bones and joints. It's good for your memory. It keeps you fit and young. But are the manufacturer's claims correct?
This one is especially for babies, and it says it helps the development of their brain and it's good for the nervous system.
That's not necessary to take fish oil pills for that.
This one is for children, and it says it helps their concentration and their memory, and it helps their learning prestations to get better.
Yeah, it's not proven.
This one is for people above 50 years old, and it says it helps the mind being active, helps them to keep up to date, and it's good for their concentration.
You don't need fish oil pills for that.
It is not fish oil, in fact, because it is made from fish, but the fish doesn't make it themselves. It is a product that they get with their food, and it's in plankton.
This one says it helps keeping your joints flexible, and it helps keeping your blood pressure stable.
Sounds good. It's not necessary to take fish pills.
Fish end up as pills in jars because we believe these pills are beneficial for our brains, muscles and joints. The European Food Safety Authority recently rejected all of these claims. And that means that manufacturers must remove these rather imaginative promises from their labels. So we don't just catch fish to eat, but we turn them into pills. We process them into fish meal for pigs, chickens, and farmed fish. When all the while we're convincing each other that fish farming is a solution for overfishing, even after more than 25 years of diving, the underwater world remains intriguing to Dos. The water's surface always looks the same. Yet once he submerges, the enchantment takes hold. And there are still unique moments.
Recently, I wrote an article about the east coast of Bonaire. And my last sentence was that I have not been able to take good pictures really close of eagle rays. Very recently, I was there again, and my first dive, very first dive, in shallow water, there was an eagle ray. And the eagle ray was eating. They eat mollusks. They find them in the sand. And I thought, oh, this is my chance. It was a spotted eagle ray. It's one of the most beautiful rays in the ocean. And I saw the eagle ray looking at me. But then I thought, okay, don't breathe. Stay calm. And then my distance in the end was 50 centimeters. And he accepted me. It was a fantastic moment. In all these years that I have been diving, 25 years, I have never been able to do this.
Doss advocates the preservation of healthy oceans because he can see the destruction with his own eyes. It is not only overfishing and its aftermath that destroy the world underwater. Coral the world over is dying because of pollution and global warming.
Yeah, when I dive here and I see all the dead corals overgrown with algae and bleached, of course, because of the high temperatures, it makes me feel very, very sad. And imagine that only a few years ago, this was a wonderful, wonderful coral reef with healthy corals. And nothing came up in my mind that it was possible to destroy them.
This devastation is also man-made. Our excessive carbon dioxide emissions are causing an underwater disaster.
The oceans are the main structures in this world that absorb carbon dioxide. And the oceans give back 70%, 70, of all the oxygen that we breathe. So we're completely dependent on the health of the oceans. And we're destroying them. It's so stupid.
When he thinks about tomorrow, he fears for his son. Oh, where are the codfish? What has gone wrong?
What's this harbor used for now?
Mostly all the boats you see here now, this is all crab fishermen.
Yeah.
Pius Coombs went to college after the fishing moratorium of 1992. He now works for a large construction company. But many of his former colleagues kept fishing and have switched from cod to crab.
Oh, where are the codfish? What have they done?
This is what's used to catch the crab. In the morning when they to go out, the haul their pots in, they bring this up on the deck of their boat, and they untie
and shake the crab out.
Much like there used to be a lot of cod, the waters off Newfoundland have been teeming with crab for as long as anyone can remember. But there seems to be a lot less of it lately.
I think if they're not careful and if government don't manage the crab stocks and if they don't learn from history, it's bound to repeat.
This is now the same thing with bluefin tuna. We have exactly the same thing. An industry that will not accept that the resource is diminishing. Therefore, they continue to fish. They continue to fish until the stock then collapse. And when it collapses, they blame everybody but themselves.
The fishing industry is responsible for the disappearance of species and the destruction of valuable ecosystems. And that is also true for so-called sustainable fisheries. We buy into the hype that fish oil pills will make us healthier, and we catch fish in order to feed them to pigs, chickens, and farmed fish. And this entire industry runs off billions in government subsidies. Every citizen is paying for the destruction of the seas and oceans. We appear to be blind to history's lessons. And just like in Newfoundland, the North Sea can also be fished empty.
It's not something that will happen one day if we don't do something. It is something that is already happening. at a very rapid rate. If you look at the North Sea, the south of the North Sea is essentially mud, but it's not in natural state. Actually, North Sea, the bottom of the North Sea, was all solid before. It was all covered with animals, and now the North Sea is already a shadow of itself. Realize this, when there was, say, 100 units, 100 tons, and then it declines to 1 ton, right? If it moves up to 2 tons, it's a doubling up. So they can go to the minister and say, the fish have doubled. Doubled is a lot. Or the fish have increased 300%, 3 tons. So they say, we have to reopen the fishery. But it's still at 3 units from 100 before. And that's the situation in North Sea. Nature that we live in. This is the only thing that we have that maintains us on the earth. And if we squander that, if we lose that, our survival on the planet is not guaranteed.
Ladies and gentlemen, what shall we do? Is there a solution? Yes, there is. We just have to stop fishing, and we have to stop eating fish. Remember, your fork is your most powerful weapon. And this is the only way, at least that's the way I look at it, that my grandchildren, they are now 6 and 8 years old, that they can enjoy the underwater world as much as I do now.
Without people, the seas and oceans would have no troubles. The choices we make now will determine the seas and our own future. It's up to us. At stores, restaurants, in our kitchens, in a voting booth, our forks are mighty weapons. Use it for a sustainable future.